So let's start at the base level. What is testosterone deficiency? It's a well-established medical condition, no surprise. We see it by low T. It negatively impacts sexuality, general health, and quality of life. The symptoms of TD, testosterone deficiency, we all know these, libido problems, erectile dysfunction, decreased energy, depressed mood, irritability, and decreased sense of well-being. These are the populations at risk, patients with congestive failure, type 2 diabetes, obesity, COPD, HIV, and chronic opioid use. And I want to emphasize the six-point chronic opioid use. We are in an opioid epidemic in the U.S. We've heard a lot about it in the news. This is one of the primary causes. And they may not be in a urology setting, but they're certainly going to be in a primary care setting. Comorbidities, there's a tremendous odds ratio with obesity, diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, osteoporosis, asthma, and COPD. What else do we know? We know as we get older, testosterone levels go down. And the question is that natural? Is it okay to happen? Probably is. What's the reasoning for that? And if we change it, if we interfere with it as providers, are we going to be helping the patient or not? And that's become the question. So what do we know with a reality check here is a high testosterone level is associated with decreased cardiovascular events. You give me an old person with an elevated testosterone level, they're going to have decreased events. That's good news. We also know that low testosterone levels are associated with increased cardiovascular events. That's what we know. That is what we know in 2017. We look at the articles. Here's one article that looked at, one review piece that looked at 19 eligible articles looking at all the factors you see, evidence in the older population that we will have decreased cardiovascular events. Here's the Araju study. I hope I'm pronouncing his name right. Meta-analysis of 18 studies, 22,000 patients. There's a kind of a detailed slide here. What you see here is studies showing that the higher your testosterone, the better it is for you, and the lower your testosterone, the more it is more strongly associated with cardiovascular mortality. This is a SHORE study. I'm sure most of you have seen it, the VA Puget Sound study. Those in the lowest level of testosterone had the highest mortality. Here's the QUA study, same thing. Low testosterone, high mortality. High testosterone, lower mortality. Well, what's the connection here? This is what we're trying to figure out. I don't think anyone really has a good answer, at least in my review. There's a lot of hypothesis out here. The bottom line is right here. Insulin resistance, endothelial dysfunction, that increases your risk of diabetes. We know diabetes is associated with cardiovascular disease, so we see increased CVD, increased stroke, erectile dysfunction. And we know erectile dysfunction now is a cardiovascular disease. So we know the connection. So why the controversy? And it's for this reason. There's kind of a good news and bad news with testosterone. Because we used to think that if you give testosterone to an older male who has low testosterone, you will make them better. Because obviously, if they have low testosterone and they have a higher risk, if we improve it, they do better. That's what we thought, but it was studied. And this is the bad news. We start with the TOM study. And in this TOM study, what we looked at was giving elderly frail patients, give them testosterone and see what happens. You see the population here, age greater than 65, the low testosterone level, a bunch of patients, 209, they titrated them up. And it showed benefit. They were better. They were stronger, like the $6 million man. All right, the problem was the safety. A lot of cardiovascular events. 23 men receiving testosterone did worse from a cardiovascular standpoint than the placebo, which was only 5. The study was terminated. It made the front page news. This is bad. Testosterone is a bad thing to do. The shortcomings, when you look at the study itself, and I encourage everyone to read it, it wasn't designed to assess cardiovascular events, so you didn't get baseline information. They didn't look at the confounding fact that if you take an elderly male, you make him stronger, he goes to the gym, he has a problem. All right? They didn't look at that. So there's a lot of bias in the study. But it's not the only study. It's one of 4. The second study is a vegan study in JAMA 2013. We were talking about that earlier this morning. In this study, what happens with testosterone therapy, mortality, associated with MI stroke with low levels. There's a retrospective study, which is important to remember, looking at guys with low T. They looked at guys who had an angiography, and then they gave them testosterone compared to those who'd never got it. And the bottom line, and I'll point this out right here, all right, there was a risk right here of 19% in the control group of a cardiovascular event versus 25.7 in the testosterone group. What does that mean? It's bad news for testosterone. It was a bad idea. This is in the initial statistical modeling. What you see here is after 3 years, testosterone supplementation increased cardiovascular events. But there were shortcomings with this. The dosage, duration, follow-up levels were not disclosed. There was no randomization, no placebo. They used propensity score weighting as opposed to raw effect. When you looked at raw effect, it actually showed a benefit. 21.2% cardiovascular disease with placebo versus 10% in treatment. I'll show that in a second. They excluded a lot of men, and with all the controversy, societies went crazy. And they retracted it. They put it in an addendum in JAMA, which, if I believe correctly, Dave, you might know this. I think that's very rare that they would put a study, they would reprimand a study in their own journal. When you look at it on the raw data and you see all of the events right here, use of testosterone was better. It improved. Okay, but that was number two study. Number three study, the Finkel study. In the plus one January 2014 edition, increased risk of non-fatal MI following testosterone use. Again, that's what makes the front page news. Study design, retrospective cohort study, looking at patients who had the risk of an acute non-fatal MI in the 90 days following prescription. They looked at a lot of patients, all right? They used 55,000 with testosterone versus others that were given PDE5, so it wasn't that was your cohort. It wasn't a true comparison. But what they found in men less than 65 years of age, if you had a prior heart history, you were at heavy risk. If you were older, it didn't matter if you had a heart history or not. The risk was twofold. What were the shortcomings? It was a retrospective study. No randomization, placebo control, serum testosterone before and after treatment unknown, dosage unknown, CV risk factors not discussed. And the final study that kind of was starting to put nails in the coffin of testosterone, the ZOO study. It was a meta-analysis, 27 placebo-controlled testosterone studies, looking at men who received testosterone for more than 12 weeks. Results. Increased cardiovascular risk. That's what they showed as the global effect. There were a lot of shortcomings. Only two of the studies provided one-third of the cardiovascular events. And if you exclude those two studies, there was actually a benefit with testosterone. And you look at this, and again, you probably can't see the font here. I clipped this directly from the paper where they said in their study they excluded cardiovascular disease in the beginning. They shouldn't have done that. And in the studies they looked at, they associated with 35% of all cardiovascular events. This is actually the spread of this. And when you look at it, it's very telling. This is testosterone. This is what favors testosterone, favors placebo. Remember, I said 27 studies. Look at this. That doesn't show me visually that testosterone is bad. It shows me, you know, this is spread all over the place. And what it also tells me is we probably need better studies. But this was the fourth of the four studies that resulted in this. We started seeing the lay press going crazy on this. New York Times editorial, February 2014, testosterone doubled the risk of cardiovascular events. These studies provide compelling evidence that we're over-treating. We shouldn't be using testosterone because we're only doing it for guys that are reluctant to say they're getting old. The FDA picked up on this in September of 2014. They came in and said, you know what, we're going to restrict this. We're going to put limitations on testosterone use on the companies. We're going to clarify that there's a danger with that, evidence linking testosterone therapy to an increased risk of heart attack, stroke, and death. They did admit that it was inconclusive, but they are taking the better part of valor, which I would agree with, and saying, you know, there's a risk. I mean, I agree with that part, with them to say it's not... We don't have a conclusive result. I like the idea of a black box warning. They advised the drug manufacturers who need better studies. I think we can all accept that. Then they came out with this announcement in March of 2015. You want to use they cautioned use of testosterone products for low T due to aging. It required labeling change to inform possible risk of heart attack and stroke with use. You know, I'm actually okay with that. I'm okay that we have this discussion with the patient, but I'm really more okay with the idea that we just don't know at this point and we need better studies. So what is the good news? What are we seeing out there in the literature that's showing that testosterone is good? Well, this is another one of the SHORE study. This is a VA study in men who were treated with testosterone, and what it shows is overall mortality was improved versus untreated patients. This is pretty busy here. This is the SHARMA study, and what they looked at was the normalization of testosterone. So they took a lot of people, they looked back, and they said, if you got testosterone, how did you compare with somebody who got, who, if you had testosterone, you got a normal level, group one. If you got testosterone, but you never got to normal level, group two, versus if you were group three, which is no testosterone at all. And the bottom line was, in group one, they did better. And you see that in the results there. They did better than group three. They did better than group two. There was no difference in the risk of MI between group two and group three, which was the non-normalization versus no T. This slide, again, I'm not sure if you can see it very well, but the bottom line was it shows that in treatment, and you've got group one versus three, you've got group one versus two, and you have group two versus three there, and the bottom line is it shows that testosterone improvement group, I'm sorry, normalization of testosterone in group one was better for all-cause mortality than two or three, and this is myocardial-free survival, and again, you see group one was better than group two and three. So with that, there was that reduction in their conclusion. There was a reduction in all-cause mortality. There are limitations, just like the other studies I mentioned. It was an observational study. There was no control when testosterone levels were drawn. So when you look in the paper, they admit we should have been doing the draws in the morning. We were doing the draws at any point of time, and that'll change it, because obviously you want testosterone in the morning. There was no randomization. We had limited data regarding who got therapy and why they did. And there was no data on why some people never made therapeutic levels. Was, again, the draw time wrong? Were they achieving something with the testosterone? They weren't getting the full dose. So there were a lot of concerns with that study. But again, it does show something that was different from the other studies. This is the Cheatham study, the showing testosterone replacement with cardiovascular outcome in men with deficiency. As you see from the study design, it's a retrospective cohort study that basically looked at primary outcomes being cardiovascular disease. They started with men that were over the age of 40 and they were given any sort of level of testosterone. The follow-up was 3.2 years in the NEVER-T. So they compared groups that never got testosterone versus men who ever got it. And when they say ever, they didn't count on how many doses you got if you were ever exposed to testosterone. And what they found was in men with androgen deficiency, the dispensed testosterone prescription, so those who ever got testosterone, and they used the word ever, they had an associated lower risk of cardiovascular outcomes over that 3.4 years. There were limitations. They didn't use the standard endocrine guidelines for identification. It was an observational design. It was unmeasured confounding issues. So the question is, were healthier patients getting testosterone and sicker patients not? They didn't have that. And the dose and duration was not controlled because it was, if you got one dose, you counted in the ever testosterone study. In the TRACE study, this is an observational prospective cumulative registry study looking at long-time effectiveness and safety in testosterone in men in a urologic setting. This study looked at 656 men. You had a treatment group getting testosterone and they followed for up to 10 years. They had 296 patients who opted against it. There were 21 deaths in the untreated group versus two in the testosterone group. So they showed a tremendous amount of benefit. When you look at that study, across the board, all parameters of cardiovascular disease were improved. They said an estimated reduction in mortality for the testosterone group was between 66 and 92%. In the untreated group, they had 30 non-fatal strokes, 26 non-fatal MIs, and none in the T group. So when you look at this paper, it looks amazing. The data is unbelievable for the benefits of testosterone. Here you have a graph I pulled from that paper. This is showing the glucose decrease. The lower is showing A1C. In primary care, that's very important to me. If I control your sugar, you're doing better. Across the board, these patients did better. It was almost unbelievable what you saw. When you look at the waist circumference, again, it was markedly improved. And we know in our patients with cardiometabolic disease, if I can get them to lose weight, they're going to be doing better. We can actually shift them out of cardiometabolic disease. So their conclusion was this was phenomenal. It worked very, very well. All parameters, the cardiometabolic, the risk of CVD events, the size, the girth, all of those helped. Mortality related to CV disease was significantly reduced in the testosterone group. It showed a significant benefit. But when you look into the details of the study, it was not designed to address testosterone mortality. There was no acknowledgement of what was happening with prior cardiovascular events. It was not randomized. I think the key point here, it was a single urologist. It was one clinic in Germany that he looked at this. So again, these were very, very good results, and it was a well thought out study. It was a well written study. But I think you have to take it with a grain of salt, single urologist, basically meaning that it would probably need to be looked at in a larger population. The other thing with that, and as I looked more into this in some of the editorials on the paper, there was a significant selection bias because you had to pay for your own testosterone. If you couldn't afford it, you weren't going to take it. So lower income people didn't get it, and that may have had some of the effect. We know higher income people tend to be healthier. And there was also no monitoring of concomitant meds. The Corona study, systematic review and meta-analysis of all controlled clinical trials on the effect of testosterone supplementation and cardiovascular disease. 75 studies were analyzed out of over 2,700. What they found was it was testosterone replacement was not related to cardiovascular risk, even when composite or single adverse events were considered. It seemed protective. The data did not support a causal role between this, so that was good. It basically said, we have data that support that hypogonadal men being treated with testosterone will do better in terms of their cardiometabolic profile, reducing body fat, increasing lean muscle mass, which would obviously are precursors, and certainly we know this from primary care, these are precursors for cardiovascular disease. This study, the Bellegren study, looking at myocardial infarction, a population-based cohort in older men getting IM testosterone, 6,300 men treated with at least one injection. It was a matched cohort to 19,000 men. You see how long they got it there. It's in the materials. The results, testosterone therapy was not associated with increased MI. What was interesting with the men in the highest risk for MI, they were the ones that did best. They had the highest reduction in MI. There was no difference in the first, second, or third, so it was in the fourth one. That's interesting. So it showed no harm to anybody, and if you were at the highest risk, you did better. So what they said, the conclusion was, is moderately protective. There were limitations. Information on outcomes and risk factors came from diagnostic codes. It came from Medicare coding. There was no assessment of comorbid states and other medications. So if you happen to be on a statin, for example, they didn't know. There was no baseline information. It was a retrospective study, which obviously could have selection bias. Let's look at two last studies here. If testosterone is going to affect cardiac disease one way or another, then what about the precursors to cardiac disease? As your coronary vessels block, you have more risk, right? That's the precursor. You can't have a heart attack without blocking the vessels. So in the Baseri study, what they looked at is the effect of testosterone administration on subclinical CAD progression in older men with lower near normal levels. They had a placebo control. You see the materials there. 308 men were looked at. They were randomized to get testosterone or not. The intimal thickness was not significantly changed. That's what they found. Their conclusion, there was no difference in the rates of change. So the precursors for cardiac disease weren't there. So if testosterone truly causes cardiac events, they did not see it. There were limitations. Because with the testosterone administration, they didn't see the improvements that we would normally see, sexual desire, erectile dysfunction, overall sexual score. So that kind of raises your eyebrows a little bit. And since it was only powered to look at CAD progression, atherosclerotic progression, you can't establish this as a benefit of cardiovascular risk, although we would assume that if it wasn't getting bigger, the occlusion wasn't getting worse, it would be better or at least the same. But there was a counter study to that, and this was published just year in 2017, the Budhoff study. This was a double-blinded, placebo-controlled study, 9 U.S. academic centers, looking at testosterone replacement in older men as slowing the progression of coronary artery plaque volume. So you see they had 170 men split between 82 to placebo, 88 to gel. The bottom line is there was an increase in plaque development with testosterone. So they did find that. They found mean total plaque volume increased, mean coronary artery calcification score also changed. There were no major cardiovascular events in either group, but that's not what they were looking at. So the conclusion, older symptomatic hypogonadal men treated with testosterone gel for a year had a significantly greater increase in CAD, in coronary artery non-calcified plaque volume. That makes us kind of raise our eyebrows again. So this is now the counter to that prior to the Becerra study. They admitted we needed larger studies to understand the clinical implications. The limitations, this was not randomized. The different baseline groups is seen because you saw that the placebo had a different baseline than the treatment group. Their prognostic studies on non-calcified plaque volume were non-existent. And then they raised the question of was this progression of bad plaque versus good plaque? Because some plaques are better than others. So the bottom line is they don't know. So there are a lot of limitations on that. So what do we know at this point? What do we know in 2017? And what have I learned after reviewing this for as long as I did? You know, their bottom line is there are three sides to every story. There's my side, there's your side, and there's the truth. And the reality of it is I don't know if we have we know the truth right now. What we do know is it really depends on the way you look at it. It's like looking at let me back up for a sec. If we don't know the truth, right? If we don't know the truth, then what happens is we're at risk. And this is what we see in the lay press. We wake up in the morning, you watch Fox News or CNN, what do you see? You see lawsuits on testosterone. And this because we don't know the absolute truth. Now, for those of us as providers, what do we do? How do we look at this? You know, here we have a horse. The horse being testosterone. How do we want to look at it? Do we want to look at the head of the horse? You know, that's one aspect. Do we want to look at the side of the horse? Or do we want to look at the rear end of the horse? I don't really know. Oh, sorry. I don't know. That one happened. Yeah. So what are my conclusions? I told you it was coming. What are my conclusions from what I've learned at this point? You know, for me, it doesn't change how I practice. I've been using testosterone for years. I'm going to continue using testosterone. All right. However, I'm going to keep track of the literature. You know, that helps me when I have to deal with legal issues. I have to be vigilant and pick the right patient. Testosterone is not for everybody. It is for the right patient. How do I do that now? I have to assess the cardiac risk. If you come into my office and you've had a heart attack and you want testosterone, chances are I'm not going to give it to you. If I'm going to consider it in you or any patient, I'm going to discuss the risks and benefits. And if you're insisting on it, maybe you sign a waiver. We have that discussion. I can involve you, but we're going to have to sign a waiver for that if I'm going to consider it. I have to discuss this. You know, as urologists, you want to discuss this with the primary care. Don't give testosterone without talking to me. That's a bad idea. And at the same time, I'm probably not going to give it to a patient without talking to you if there's a risk of, you know, if maybe they've had prostate cancer and it's treated. I mean, we know we can do that now, but I'm going to talk to you about it. I'm going to talk to the cardiologist. I do that all the time. If I have a patient with which I think might have a risk, I may send him in for cardiac evaluation. So we have to continue that communication. And as Dr. Cookson mentioned before, that great slide on what we have here is a failure to communicate. How we improve this is we communicate. And the final thing is document, document, document. This is a moving target. Using testosterone is okay. Document, 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 because I don't know what the future is going to hold. Thank you.